The very longed-for rain is falling in Växjö as well as in Kalmar for the first time this year, it feels like. And we are inside, thanks God, and we are going to have fun with JavaScript all day long. So that's the plan for today. You are probably in the course right now where you're starting looking at the assignment for next week, maybe. This lecture is the last one, the last puzzle, the last bit of the puzzle you need to take on the assignment. And I should also say that together with this lecture, I have an extended demo. It's like 2 hours where I solve a similar but different assignment from the one you are doing. And you will find, and you find that demo on the course homepage. So head over to this lecture's tab, and there is an extended Ajax demo on the page. So have a look at that after this lecture. It's mandatory, more or less, because it's a part of. I won't have time to code a lot today because that takes a lot of time. So I have this extended demo instead, and many of the questions I got before this lecture is actually answered in that demo. So please have a look at that one. One more practical issue is that next week I will be away on vacation, so the examinations will be handled by John, Mats, and Jacob. And to be able to fit everybody in on the Wednesday, we will try to do all examinations over Skype next week. So you will more or less go into a room online and write your Skype ID. Some of you did this the last time. Add your Skype ID, and we will call you up one by one, more or less. But you will still book time, so you know which time slot you have. But it could be like plus minus 5 minutes from the time slot. We will probably try to squeeze in some re-examinations from the first assignment for those of you who failed that exam or didn't hand it in. So look forward to that for next week. And if you are having problems, please write in Slack. We could always book meetings over Skype. So we have resources in Kalmar that are ready to help you if you have problems. So just give us a call on Slack or ping us or anything, and we could help you right away, more or less, depending on the time of the day. Yeah. Yeah, so if you have any problems with assignments or the exercises, please just ping us on Slack, like send us a message and we will call you up using Skype. I did it with a couple of you last week. Okay, great. A lot of cover today. So you probably heard this concept of Ajax, maybe. It's a concept I will focus somehow on today. Together with storage, and I will focus on it because it's important when it comes to the second point on this slide, the asynchronous programming versus the more synchronous programming models. And we will focus on asynchronous programming in this lecture. And that's kind of a different way of looking on the program flow than you are used to. But we will have a look at that. I didn't have time to finish or talk about the queue and the event loop last week, so we will start off by discussing that. We discussed events last week, and we will continue on that path because Ajax and asynchronous code is more or less the same as event-driven programming that we looked on last week. We will have a look at HTTP and leading up to Ajax. And web storage will also be a part of this lecture. I will also say a few words about promises and generator functions. Promises is a part of the extended demo. So I basically write the demo in a certain way, and then I rewrite the demo using something called promises. So the code is in the demo, but I will touch upon it on this lecture as well. So, no. Reload. The event queue. Last week we talked about events, and events were something that happens when, like, the user interacts with a web page, or the web page loads, or anything else happens in the browser. Then an event is triggered, and somewhere in the future, the code for that event will be run. And this is done using something called a queue. In Java or many other languages, you have threads, so you can, like, code multi-threaded applications doing several things at once. You all know what that can be problematic sometimes, because if you share, like, resources, try to write to the same variables and stuff, you will get into trouble, and you have techniques for solving those issues and basically not getting into trouble. So that's a threaded model. JavaScript, from the developer's perspective, is using a different model altogether. And that is a queue model. So we can start off by saying that this is not entirely true, but we can say that JavaScript is single-threaded. We only have one thread. So we start out by that mindset. In the background, there are a lot of threads, but we can focus on that we have one thread, and that's represented by the queue. So when you write code, you add it to the queue, and the code is executed in order. So this is kind of a FIFO structure. So the first thing entering the queue is the first thing executed in the queue, and everything stacks up afterwards. So if we look at this program up here, the first thing that will happen, I will not be able to draw because we haven't got those screens to work yet. So I will illustrate this in another way soon. But the first thing that happens is that this program will be added, sort of, to the queue, or the stack, if we should be more precise. So the code will start to run. And it will see that, okay, we have a function here called hello, so it will, like, remember that. It will add it to the heap, and it will remember that we have a function called run and add that function to the heap. And when it comes down to the last line, it says, oh, we are executing code. It will execute the run function, so it will call the run function. The run function will end up on the stack. It will start executing the code inside of run. Then it comes to this line of code, set timeout. And then it finds out that, okay, so we are setting a timeout to 0 milliseconds. That's like execute the code right now, because the timer is set to 0. But what happens is, I will try to draw anyways. Let's see if this works. It's a little bit low, but we will try. I have pens with me as well. See if you will be able to see this, but so this hello is a reference to that function, and we are saying by setting timeout, so we are saying that, okay, add run hello in 0 milliseconds. What does this mean? First of all, we have, can you see this? Yep. In the queue right now, we have this code that is actually running. And when we come to this line and set timeout, hello will be added to the queue. Because the 0 milliseconds says that add it to the queue right away. It doesn't say execute it in 0 milliseconds. It says add it to the queue in 0 milliseconds. And the web browser will do that. So it will add hello to the queue. And our code will still be executing, because this one is the first one in the queue. And then it will log, I run, it will log very fast, and then this code will end because there is nothing left to do. Run is over, everything is done, and this will be removed from the stack. Which is the same to say as it will be removed from the queue. So the code is finished, and this blue part will be removed from the queue. So the next part in the queue is the hello, and now the hello function will be run, and it will log, when do I say hello? So looking at this code, you might think, if you just are new to JavaScript, you might think that, okay, so we run the code, we are setting a timeout to 0 milliseconds, so this one will be called right away, and it will say, when do I say hello, and after that I run very fast. But that's not true, because this only says, the timeout says, add it to the queue. And the same thing is true for everything that happens in the browser. So if you're adding an event handler for a click event, and the user, when I run this code, the user clicks something on the web page, that won't interrupt our code that is running. It will only tell the browser to add the click or the function connected to the click to the queue. And say that you are making an AJAX request, we will have a look at them later. You're making a request to another server and a response comes in, it will be added to the queue. If you have another API in the browser that you are talking to, it might also add stuff to the queue. So when we have a look at this model, it's really, really important to not write code in this queue that blocks stuff, that blocks execution. Because if you are, say you are writing a while true for some reason inside of run, then you will block the queue. Nothing else will happen. The browser, if we are in the browser will freeze. The browser won't even be able to render stuff. So if the user are trying to hover a link, for instance, then the browser must trigger a re-render because the color of the link might change on the hover. It won't be able because the queue is clogged. So it will feel like the whole application froze. Yeah.
So is that the same timeout that's gonna put the function in the queue, or what's gonna happen if you're gonna execute direct call the function?
If you instead of set timeout would have called hello, then it would be just as normal. The hello function will be called, it will be run, and it will all like
So
you can say that set timeout is a way of making asynchronous code, because what you talked about is synchronous code, the type of code we are used to when we have a function calling another function and everything runs and then the program exits. But when we have events, when we have timeouts, when we have stuff like this, we are programming in an asynchronous way. We are just telling the browser to call us when something is happening. And setting zero says to the browser, add this to the queue, more or less. It actually says, add a timer to zero, and when it's finished, add it to the queue. But in reality, it's adding it to the queue right away. So I will not dwell on upon this more than this. I want you right now to understand that writing code that locks the queue is really, really bad. Because we only have one queue. That's a truth in modifications. Later on, we will discover that we have more queues. We could actually start different queues doing calculations and stuff with something called web workers. But for now, we say that we only have one, or at least we only have one main queue. There is a really, really, really good demo called What the Heck is the Event Loop Anyway? I have linked that as a mandatory resource to this lecture, where this is explained in a little bit more detail. And the guy having that talk has also programmed an application called Loop that we could have a look at. Yeah, here is the talk, by the way. So if you go into Loop, you will find the talk on the start page. So here is our example, but in the running the application loop. And this application visualizes what happens in the browser when we're running our code. So if you are having a hard time getting all the concepts, you can always try to write your code inside of Loop to be able to see what happens. And when this code is executed, a lot of pauses are made so that it's running really slow, just to make a point of what is happening. So this is exactly the same example that I had. We have our queue down here called the callback queue. And the thing that is fetching stuff from the queue and adding them to the call stack is the event loop. So if you are reading about the event loop, that's more or less this system of getting things from the queue, adding them to the call stack. Up here, the big box, we have the web APIs. This is actually the browser doing threaded things, like setting timeouts, executing networks calls, monitoring the browser for user interaction. So the web APIs are adding all of those calls to the callback queue. So if we execute this one, save and run, we see that everything is happening quite quickly. So let's take that one more time and I will pause. So the first thing that happens is that our code is added to the stack, the run method is run, and the set timeout is executed. And in the set timeout, the hello function is added to the web API by the set timeout, like that. And now the web browser is executing the timeout. In this case, I changed it to 2 seconds. So the web browser is waiting 2 seconds for this one to finish, and then it will add it to the callback queue. Like that. This program, during the time we waited, this program continued to execute. The hello function is now in the queue, but the stack is occupied by the run function. So when the run function returns, the call stack is free, and we could move things from the callback queue. Free, and the event loop will take what's in the queue, add it to the stack, and execute the code. So if you get this, it's really good, because this is more or less the programming model you will be working with. There are more things to complicate this. Maybe we could add them. Yep. So the browser is actually all the time re-rendering the page as well. And so let's rerun this. And you see, when our code is running, the re-render stops. But then our code finished run, then the browser could render the page before our hello callback. So this queue, the render queue, is prioritized. So if you are doing a lot of DOM handling, adding events to the page will re-render this when the call stack is empty for the first time, and before other events have the possibility to be added to the stack. You don't have to think about it that much, but it's good to know that even the browser rendering is dependent on you not writing code that occupies the queue all the time, or actually writing code that occupies the stack or freezes the stack, like while true or other types of code that we will have a look at. So for you following this not on campus, I will try to have a look in the in the Slack channel, and John will forward questions from live coding. Okay. That's the cue. Now, let's see how to not do it. So, we are going to talk about AJAX, or we are going to talk about communicating from the browser to other servers, because basically that's what's making the web great as a platform, the ability to contact and contact other servers, loading data in the background without interrupting the user. And this is the technique for that is called AJAX, and we will have a look at different techniques as well. But in the early days of AJAX, no, I'm not there yet. Oh, heck. Blocking code. Yeah, I should say I was one slide ahead. So why is this code bad? Okay, have a look at this code. It's more or less the same as the last example, with one thing different, and that is that we are using something called alert. Alert is those boxes, sometimes not that much anymore, but back in the day they were popping up like with a warning sign, and you would have to press OK. That was an alert box. There are different boxes as well, prompt boxes that makes you add something to a prompt, like write your name or something. Those boxes are have been built in since the dawn of JavaScript in the browser, but they are really, really bad, and they are bad because they are blocking everything. They are synchronous. So when this code runs and we come to the line that says alert, the execution will stop and wait for alert to return. An alert will not return until the user clicks OK. We now know what that means. That means that this is in the stack and nothing else can be executed. So everything that is happening when the alert box is up is just added to this queue. It just built up on the queue, added to the queue. And we could see that I have a fiddle with this code. So right now, when I started this page, the code was run and an alert box came up. And have a look at the background. This is an editor, a fiddle editor, and you can see that even the cursor in the editor has stopped blinking. And that's because the browser is not allowed to re-render the page anymore. So this call is blocking everything. And if you are having an application where you have a lot of things going on in the background, network calls being made, which is often the case, all those calls are happening if they were initialized. But the result of those calls are just added to this call stack, and it will, or the queue, and the queue will just grow. And when I click OK, everything starts re-rendering, and the queue is processed from the bottom to the top. I haven't talked about alert. This is a classic thing to maybe say in JavaScript in the browser, that you can use alerts. You should never use alerts, never ever. Just stop if you are, because you will run into problems like this. Okay, they are like good to use sometimes in debugging purposes, that you actually want to stop the code in a certain place. You could use alerts for that if you like. But you could also write debugger. That will basically be the same thing, stopping the code from executing using the debugger instead. Okay. So, enough about let's get down to the example I just talked about, I think. Come on. Okay, so asynchronous programming versus synchronous programming. Synchronous programming you're quite used to, because that's, I mean, you do something, you get a result, you take the result and do something else with the result, and you just write a simple program. Threads, however, more complicated story. We don't have threads in JavaScript, so I will not touch upon that. but we have asynchronous programming instead. So let's look at this example. It's just a timeline, and the purple code, let's say it's the user interacting, like we are asking the user a question in a form or something like that. Write your name. And then we have this yellow code that might be a network call to fetch something from the server. And the blue code is dependent on the yellow code for something. So we fetch something from the server, get the response, and we do something with that response. So if you do this synchronously, you will probably ask the user to input something and then wait, even though the network traffic isn't dependent on what the user is writing. Okay, so in the synchronous model, the user, which will be probably a lot longer than this purple line, will write his or her name. And when that is done, we process the name and do something with it. After that, we set up the network call, and we wait for the call to finish. When it's finished, we are executing something with the data we got. In the asynchronous model, we could notice that, okay, we could actually do the network call and the user interaction parallel, because they have nothing to do with each other. Even if the user is finished before or after, doesn't matter for the construction of our program. So what we do is we are asking the user to write his or her name using some kind of form. And at the same time, or slightly after, we are initiating a network request. The network requests will be finished, and we will act upon the network request with the data we got. So of course, this is more effective, the last one, because we don't need to wait for the user. So this is mainly the difference in this case. If we break it down, it will look something like this. I'm not sure I like this chart, but it's there anyway. So what I want to illustrate is that the top line, you see, that's more or less the call stack. So in the beginning of the program, we need to set up the user interaction. We do that on the call stack, maybe adding a form to the DOM. We are setting up a button and adding an event handler to the click, something like that. We are initiating the network request, telling the browser to go fetch something. And then the call stack is finished because there is nothing else to do. Now we're just waiting. And so those yellow and purple blocks, they are code that executes somewhere, or it's interactions happening somewhere apart from the stack, like the user sitting in front of his or her computer writing the name, or network traffic, server working, response being sent back. And when something is returned, it's added to the queue. The loop fetches it, adds it to the stack, and executes some code. And we continue like this. Somewhere in the long future, the user will have written his or her name, and the same thing happens. We act upon the name. So if you have a look, if you write good code like this, the stack will not be flooded all the time. There is a lot of space left for other applications or re-rendering and things like that. But if you have done this in a synchronous way, all of those calls will be on the stack all the time, which would be really, really, really bad. Now we are just using the stack as little as possible. So, yeah, the example wasn't here that I thought about. It will come. I need to touch upon HTTP first, though. So, we are slowly getting into communicating with other servers, and when we are communicating with other servers, we need to just have a brief look at the HTTP protocol. How many of you were familiar with the HTTP protocol before? Some, maybe the ones reading network security, or? Yeah, probably. Just a quick summary. Hypertext Transfer Protocol was created at the same time as HTML. It's the protocol for delivering HTTP, or delivering HTML documents. We have four main methods. There are more than those, but those might be the four that is most important to know about right now. And the method is like, we have the protocol, and in the protocol we have those methods, and the methods is how it's a method of communicating with the server. How will the communication or what are our intents to do with the server? And the methods you are probably most familiar with is get and post. So get is actually, okay, telling the server, I want to get something from you. Like, more or less every call, when you write an address in the address bar in the web browser, it's a get request, because you are telling the site you're writing the server, that I want to get this page, I want to fetch the page, just to have a look at it. If you fill out the form with your name and stuff, press submit, you will probably do a post, because post actually says add something. Help me, John. I always mix those two up. I think it says add something new, while put says update something, but we have patch as well, so that might not be all that true. But generally, you could say that post is add something new to the server, and put is update something, and delete is quite obvious. You want to delete the resource. Like if you are a member, you have a register of members, and you are deleting a member in the interface, then you're sending a delete message to the server saying, okay, delete this person. However, the form in HTML, the form tag, only supports get and post. So if you're using form and the submit button to send something to the server, you are probably only using get or post. So if you are used to like writing PHP code or something like that, then you often use a post when you want to delete something, and then you have some kind of hidden field telling the server that, okay, this post means I actually want to delete, because you're not able to send a delete using forms. But we will not use forms that much. We will have the forms as containers for user interfaces, like input buttons and stuff. But we will do the interaction using JavaScript in the background and using the network APIs instead of using the built-in form. So when we do that, we could use all of the HTTP methods. And what we are communicating with on the server, in best of cases, the server is just an API, or REST API or something like that, that we send commands to and we get a response back. And that's actually the first assignment, because there you have a REST API on the server. You are, first of all, sending a GET request to get a question from the server. You're saying, okay, I want to get the first question. You get a question back from the server. Then the user answers the question. You present the question to the user. The user adds an answer, like 2. What is 1 + 1? I think the first question is. And you write 2. And then when the user clicks submit, or clicks a button or a link or something that indicates that the response should be sent, you do a post to the same API, but you're sending the answer with the post. And then you continue with post and get to get new answers and sending in new questions. In this first assignment, we don't use put and delete, because that's a read-only API. So you are not able to delete anything or add something or modify something. But for those of you reading the next course, you will be using all of those in a larger application. Okay. So when you initialize the request, you will get a response back. So you says get this page, you will get the response back. And with the response, you get some status codes. You will really, really know that after the assignment, because you get a lot of status codes all the time, telling you that you did something wrong, or we did something wrong, or something else happens. So the most normal one is the 200. So that's basically everything is fine, done, okay. So if you answer a question correctly, you will probably get the 200 okay back. The 300 numbers, starting with the first digit starting with a 3, they are some kind of redirection. Some resource has have moved, either temporarily or permanent. It could be that, for some reason this resource moved, and if it's temporary, it will probably get back in the near future. You have the right URL, but right now we have temporarily moved this. That's good for like search engines to know if, okay, should I update the index, or is my index actually correct, but it's wrong on the server. We won't use them too much, but we will use the 400 span. 400 means you have done something wrong, and that's really important for the first assignment. If you get a 400 back, you have done something wrong. And that wrong could be like you did a bad request. You didn't, I mean, the server wanted something in a special format and you didn't deliver that. So the server just said, no, this is a bad request, try it again. That will happen a lot of times, I guess. You could get unauthorized. So you are probably trying to like do a delete on a question, something like that. You are not allowed to do that. You will get an unauthorized. That's not a part of the assignment. You could get a forbidden. Okay, you have access to this resource, but you are forbidden to do what you are trying to do. You're not allowed to do that. Dave. Right? What's his name? No. Over the top of everybody's head. Okay, next one, not found. You probably know this one, right? Happens all the time. If you write a URL and it's not found, then you did something wrong. You wrote a false URL. It's not the server's fault that you wrote it wrong. Often though, the resource has disappeared from the server, so might be the server's fault anyways. 500 span, that's us doing something wrong looking at the assignment. So something is wrong with the server. The database has crashed, so we can't access it. Something else has happened. So if you get a 500 back, something is wrong on the other side. Nothing you can do about it. Or the problem could originate in you doing something that making the server crash. So you could, of course, do something wrong, but that wrongdoing should not probably lead to a 500 back. So if you get a 500, not your fault, as long as you are not on the server side. So the status code, just to give a quick look, the inspector is really, really good to have in those cases. Could have a look at the network. I'm actually at localhost right now, I think. Yeah, maybe it doesn't matter. So I re-rendered or reload the page. We could have a look just at some headers. No, this is no good. Let's go to, where did I end up? My God, what's that? New.se. No. Oh, well, here it is. So let's have a look. Reload, network, reload. Pending. Uh-oh, low on battery, shite. Forgot the power. Oh, quick. I have a really bad battery as well, so. Okay, so it loaded. We could have a look at the resource. We could take the first one, maybe. And what we want to look at right now is the, whoop, no. It's the stuff down here. So this is the headers. That's the information sent to the server. So we are doing a request. We have the request down here. This is a parsed request. We could view the source of the request. Then we see we're doing a get using HTTP 1.1 to the host lnu.se and the slash. We are not asking for a specific page. We are just contacting the lnu.se. And the browser is telling the server a lot of stuff, like which user agent I'm using. This is a Mozilla 5.0. It is nothing like Mozilla. This is Chrome. But as I said last time, since the browser wars, this user agent tag is filled with a lot of stuff that shouldn't be there. It says that it's Apple WebKit. It's not anymore. It's Blink. It's like a gecko, and it's some kind of Safari. So it's just saying a lot of stuff that doesn't really matter anymore. Since it's not Safari, it's not it's Chrome. It says what we are accepting. It sends some cookies. I will get into that later. And we get a response back. And the response says, okay, so this is a HTTP 1.1 response. It's a 200. It's okay. So we got the page. So you could always investigate what the response looked like. You can go in, okay, what was the response? Oh, it looked like this. Great. This is really, really important in the first assignment. So have this network tab open when you're doing the requests, because you could learn a lot. Just wanted to show that quickly. One more thing before we take a break. Yeah, so this is more or less what I showed you, but I filtered it. So the request looks something like this, and the response that we get back. So in the response, what we couldn't see, but the response is actually first the headers is in the top of the response. And then when the header is done, then comes the like the HTML code, for instance, if you are requesting an HTML file. We have some information that this is content type text HTML. And that's good to know for the browser. Because if you forget this doc type, for instance, it will still parse this as an HTML document because the server says that it is of the type text HTML. And the server will probably say that because it's in a .html file. So it will figure out that it should set it as a text HTML. But this content type is really important in the assignment. Because in the assignment, you're not always, or you're not ever, sending HTML back and forward. You're sending JSON. I will get into JSON later on. But you're sending JSON. And then you need to tell that the things you're posting, if we do a get post, what are the things? Is it JSON? Is it text? Is it HTML? What are we sending to the server? So the server knows what you are sending in. I omitted the content type in this request, but we should have it in the request as well. When we post something to the server, we should have a content type set for what is set. So if you look at this one, this get request, we have added parameters to the URL in the top. And you could probably see that if you go to Google and Google something, you will have this query in the top of the URL. So you could copy that query, you could copy the URL, send it to someone else. If they go into that, they will do the same search as you did. They will not get the same result, probably, but they will do the same search. So if you are like doing applications that the browser should be able to bookmark, for instance, like a search, then you could use get parameters. We will look at later on, when we look at SPA applications, we will use something more sophisticated for tracking the state of an application than this. But this is commonly used. But this is not a good way if you're doing a login form, for instance, with a username and password. You're not that good to send a username and password in the URL. First of all, you can't encrypt it if you do, because it's in clear text. If someone looks over the shoulder of the person writing his or her credentials, they will be able to read the password in the URL. On the way to the server, this URL could be cached in ISP providers, for instance, and then the username and password will be cached as well at the ISP. So never ever send critical information using the get parameters. It's better to use the post. It's better to use the post in that case, because in post you say that, okay, we're doing a post to the server page, and then we are adding content to the request. So in this case, we are sending the username and, for instance, a password that way instead. If you do send username and password, of course, you should have an encrypted connection to the server. We will look at that later. But it's better, anyways, than to do it using get. And then we get a response back. So, yeah, I will say this and then we will have a break. So, what I was supposed to tell you, I tried to tell you before, you should never ever block this queue. I've said it many times today. And this is a way of doing it. When the AJAX or XML HTTP request API found itself into the browser in the late 90s using an ActiveX component from Microsoft, they made it so that you are able to do a synchronous or asynchronous request to the server. So we will have a look at the synchronous first. And this one is the one that everybody thinks is, oh, it's so easy to do this, so I will try to do this all the time. But it's really, really bad. And actually, it's that bad that in the later standards of this API, they have removed the possibility to do this. So if you try to run this code in Chrome and Firefox, you will just get an error because they have removed the possibility to run code like this. So what's happening? Okay, we're doing a new XML HTTP request, and that's the API for doing requests to other servers. It's as simple as just initiating a new object of that class, or type, I should say. Then we configure the request using open. So request.open, the first argument is the HTTP method. In this case, we want to get a resource, so we add get. You could add it in capitalized or lowercase if you like, it doesn't matter. We, as a second argument, we are telling what resource do we want to fetch. If you write a relative, like a file like this, it will use the actual URL you're at and contact your own server and getting data from that same directory, so to speak. You could add the full http://, blah, 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 resource.com/something/something. If you do this on another server than your own, you could get an error, and I will get into that soon as well. Third parameter, this one is removed in newer versions of the API. You could add false, and false actually means do this synchronously, not asynchronously. And then we do a send, request.send. And when we do the request.send, the network call is being made. But send will never return until you get an answer back from the server. So the code will freeze right here on the stack. It will just wait. So everything will just freeze. When the server is called, the server is doing stuff, maybe contacting a database, maybe fetching other data, constructing the answer and sending response back. Could take like 300 milliseconds, could take 2 seconds. We don't know. But when we get an answer, this request will start, or the code will start executing again because send will return. And then we could, with request.response text, write the response we got back. It's a pretty simple model. I mean, okay. New object, configure it, send, and write the result. Straightforward, synchronous, easy to understand. Bad. Let's have a look. This is like, if this timeline is the stack, we're doing the new HTTP request, we're opening it, and we're sending it, and then everything stops. We have no idea how long this will take, but when it returns, we could continue. So during this time, the user will not be able to do anything on your page. Everything is frozen. do not ever write code like this, even though it feels tempting because it's so easy. Let's just pretend for a moment. It's beeping in my pocket. Could be a bad sign. No. Let's just pretend that we kind of remove this false. That will make this an asynchronous request instead. Is it that easy? Ooh, we just remove the false and everything works? Or what will happen? What do you think will happen? Will we get a problem? So if we remove this, send will return immediately. It will not wait until it gets an answer. And what will be the problem with this code in that case? Yeah, we don't have a response text because send will return immediately and the next line of code will be executed. But we haven't gotten any response yet. For the sake of the program, the response will be like forever away because this runs with microseconds and the response will take maybe a second. So this response text, this request.response text is undefined. So we will just print undefined and go on. And when the request comes back, nothing will happen because we haven't written any code to say that we should handle this. So after the break, we will have a look at how to write this to take care of the response, basically. We will continue soon. I just got a message from John that I will clarify for next week for the oral hearings. We will try to do them over Skype for everyone. Please just try out Skype with the microphone and stuff using the test call function in Skype on beforehand so that you know that your mic is working and the speakers are working. If you have some kind of headset, it's okay with just a regular phone headset or something like that. That's the best because if you're using the built-in speakers and the microphone, we could get some sound problems. If you have a webcam, it's preferable. Otherwise, we will try to manage without the webcam as well. So. And if you have any problems with any of those things doing it over Skype, just let us know and we will find an alternative way of doing it. Okay, that's that. And just for the afternoon, we are having the first peer instruction starting at 1 or 1:15. That will be an offline experience, so we will not stream the peer instructions. So make sure to be here at 1:15. It's not mandatory, but I urge you to be here because you will find it useful for the examination next week. Okay, so this was the synchronous model, bad, and we will try to redo this in an asynchronous way. So how will it look? Yeah, we know that we can't just remove the false and everything will be okay because, as we said, we will not have the response text yet. So what you do when you do this asynchronously is more or less like you do with events. So we add an event handler or event listener to the XML HTTP request object. So when the XML HTTP request object returns or gets an answer back, it will let us know and we can do something else meanwhile. So the only difference here is I removed the false from the open and I added an event listener. And inside that event listener, I added the code to be run when we get a result. And you see, I do it using the load keyword. You might see this is a newer way of doing it. In older examples, you will probably see something like on ready state changed, that you write request.onReadyStateChanged. That works perfectly fine. This is more like the V3C way of doing it. On ready state changed stems from the Microsoft implementation. We could also, I think there is an event listener for error, for instance. So if we get an error on the request, we could act upon that. In my example, I will use them both. So if we look at the time chart for this code instead, this looks much better. Okay, we are creating a new HTTP request, we're adding the event listener, we are opening or configuring the request, we are calling send, and send will return immediately. So after send returns, the browser can do things. It could render, the user can interact with the page, and the network traffic will be handled in the background by a thread in the browser. And when the browser gets an answer, it will add a response to the queue. And as soon as the stack is empty and we are next up in the queue, this message will be added to the stack. And this code up here on the function that we provided will be run. So it's a pretty simple model still. But you need to wrap your mind around that things not happening in a sequential order. We don't know. I mean, for all we know, this request could take somewhere between a couple of milliseconds if we are doing it localhost to several seconds if we are doing it over the network on a bad connection, for instance. So we can never write code that depends upon this happening in a certain timing. I see example of students writing code like this. No, oh whoa, like this. But they add this console.log inside of a set timeout. So you set a timeout for 3 seconds, and then we run that code, and it will work. Most cases it will work as long as the connection isn't more than 3 seconds away. And if you're running it localhost, you could probably get around with like 200 milliseconds. And the application will be snappy like this. But as soon as you publish this on Amazon or somewhere, and someone on a bad connection is using your application, it will break because the timer of 200 milliseconds is too small. So if you find yourself in a situation where you think that, oh, I will solve this using a timer for a certain amount of time, just to wait for this request to return. Think again. There is a better way of doing it. And the better way is just adding to the, telling the browser to tell us when the browser is finished. Questions on this slide. This is a key to much of the course. The rest I will say is more or less I don't know the English word, but överkurs in Swedish. Overcourse. No. Okay. So, Ajax. This concept has been around for 10 years, more than 10 years. It's was presented by Jesse James Gareth in an article called Ajax, A New Approach to Web Applications in 2005. But actually, the XML HTTP request object that he presented and made a use case for, like loading things in the background, that paradigm that we are living in right now, that was invented back in 1999 in Internet Explorer. So Microsoft added this into Internet Explorer 5 in 1999. But it wasn't really used, not much anyways, until Jesse Jarrett wrote this article in 2005. Then it's exploded. And actually, I would say that a big part of JavaScript being the popular language it is today is due to this article. Because before 2005, JavaScript was this toy language that actually other teachers told me that, are you still teaching JavaScript? But why don't you like do Flash or something that is useful? But that was pre-2005. After this kind of revolution in 2005 and browser support added for those techniques, JavaScript has evolved a lot. But remember, it was Microsoft, and Microsoft had done really good stuff in Internet Explorer. But the bad thing is they added this as an ActiveX control inside of Internet Explorer, making it more or less an IE thing only. However, a couple of years later, Mozilla, Safari, and Opera, they all added this in that standard way we have it today, but they mimicked how the ActiveX control worked. So you could use the same, I mean, open, send, the parameters, or the argument list, they are the same as in the ActiveX controller. So back in the day, we had to write initiate the XML HTTP request in different ways. But nowadays, we could just do it using the standard implementation. And 2006, Microsoft gave up on the ActiveX controller and added native support for the XML HTTP request object in the same way as the other browsers. So this is from IE7, you can use it in the same way. So today we can. Okay, but you can read this article if you like. It's historical. So I said that when doing the request, I wrote data.json here, but you could actually write an address to another server. You could like write github.com/ to get a file on GitHub, if you like, and you will download that file. And this makes it so that you could actually, if you like, add JavaScript files on GitHub, and when you load your script, you can fetch those JavaScript files, add them using the script tag to the document, and make them execute. If it's not your files, it's quite dangerous, but you could. However, there is a limitation to this, and it's called cross-origin resource sharing. And this is a security device inside of the browser. So if you are trying to do this kind of cross-site requests, reading data from other servers, the other server must say that it's OK. If it doesn't, then the browser will block this request. And you will get something looking like this. You will probably get something looking like this on the last assignment in the course. And it will say, XML HTTP request cannot load the resource Sunet.se. No access control allow origin header is present on the requested resource. Origin localhost is therefore not allowed access. If you get this message, it means that you are trying to contact another server with an XML HTTP request, but that server will not permit it. In that case, you can do one of, I would say, three things. You can do a hack and get around this mechanism using techniques called JSONP or using like trying to load an image, or there are hacks that you can get around this security feature. However, the two good ways of doing this is if you are in control of the server, you can always configure the server telling it that it will send this header allow browsers to read the data. You could set this quite fine-tuned. You can say that those domains are allowed to read data from my server, or you can say that all domains with an asterisk is allowed to read from this server. GitHub has the asterisk, so you can read from GitHub best you like. However, if you don't control the server, it's quite hard to write a message to a server owner and asking them to adding your domain to the permitted list. Then, instead, you can use something called a proxy, more or less. So if we have this code or this setup, and now we will not see, but it says third-party server down here. So, first of all, the browser will get the page from us, from our server, and back it will get a page. On this page, you have a JavaScript. And the JavaScript in the browser wants to read from this server, and it will try. It will send the request to the server, and the server will actually respond with the data and everything, but it will not have this cross-origin header set. Then the browser will say, uh-oh, no, your script is not allowed to read this data. Okay, so how to do it instead? Well, then you have to do it like this. You have to contact your server, telling the server that it should fetch the data, get it back, and send it as a response back, like that. So you are using your server as a proxy to get the data, because servers don't have this restriction. It's only the browsers that are looking at this cross-origin header. So servers could communicate with every other server and getting data from everywhere. So if you find yourself in a situation where you cannot contact a third-party server, you could always do it like this. In this course, however, we are not writing code on the server. So for this course, you will not be able to use this method. And you will not probably get this error message either if you're not doing something on your own, I realize. In the next course, however, you will be able to set those headers on the server to be able to communicate it with in a better way. However, you are always, your scripts stemming from this server is always allowed to contact that server. So you are always allowed to read files from your own domain, own server. Okay. This leads up to something called the callback pattern. And now we will have a look at code, so stay awake. This could be quite messy, but we'll try to wrap our minds around it. So, actually, I'm doing two things in this example. First of all, I will start with the easy one. First of all, in JavaScript, when you're calling functions, you might be used to having quite a lot of parameters, and you're using default parameters, and you're even using overloading to have different functions with different set of parameters. If you have the same function or method that takes, the one function takes a string and the other one takes an int, but they have the same name. We don't have overloading in JavaScript, as I said before, so we can't do that. But in other languages, it's quite usual that you send in a lot of arguments to a function when you call it. There are problems with that. Okay, so if I don't want to provide the first three arguments, I only want to provide the fourth, okay, then I need to have some kind of protocol saying I will set them to null or something like that. Or the order is wrong in the parameter list. They should have been the other way around. So there are some problems like that. And in JavaScript, it's really, really common that instead of sending a lot of arguments into a function, you just send an object. So you create an object, you send it to the function, and inside of the object is what we usually call the arguments, like properties. So if we just focus on that part in this case, so we have a function up here that as a first parameter takes the config, and as the second takes the callback. So we have the parameter config and callback, and we forget the callback for now, and we focus on the config. So this is what this function will do is make a request to a server. And when writing a function that will make a request to a server, there are certain arguments we need. We need like method, we need URL, we might need some data if we are doing a post, and so on and so on. The list will go on. And we will probably discover more and more arguments we need as we go along. So instead of just adding them, like URL, and then method, and so on, we just provide a config object. And when we look at how we call this function down here, we are sending in an object. So we are just creating an object with name and value pairs, with properties. So we say that, okay, we send in the prop method get and the URL data. And then it's up to the function to handle what happens if there are no method, what happens if there are no URL. Now I have no error handling, not much anyways, in this code, because error handling, as you know, will take up a lot of space and will not fit this slide. But of course, we should check, okay, so if there are no methods that has been set, we should set a default method to get. If the URL is not provided, maybe we should call the same URL as we are at, and so on. In my example, I will do that error handling, so you get to see how that's done. But this has a good flexibility, because if this function needs more arguments, it's just to add them in the object. You don't need to alter the signature of the function. You just in the documentation you say, okay, we have added those parameters if you like to do this and that. So this is a pattern of calling functions and APIs in JavaScript that is really, really common if you start looking at other people's code. So I start using it here as well. So that's the config part of this. That's not actually what this slide is about, because the slide is about the callbacks. And callbacks, as you know, in JavaScript, we have higher order functions, so we can send functions in, like we did using the asynchronous example. So what I've done here is I have wrapped or created a function to make asynchronous JavaScript calls. So I'm wrapping all of the other code inside of a known function. Pretty much like if you have used jQuery, you have the Ajax function. It does more or less the same. It's not that much of a difference right now. Back in the days, it was a bigger difference to do this, because you have the Microsoft way of doing things and you have the standard way of doing things. But today might not be that important to do this, but I did it anyway just to show this callback pattern. So we are exporting a function called request, so we could import it with require in another file. That's pretty much what I'm doing, and I'm saying that the request is this function. And this function takes a config where we send in the config parameters, and it takes a callback. And the callback is the function to be called when everything has worked out fine, when we got a response back. The first thing we do is we instantiate a new request. We add the event listener to the load, run some code. When it's done, we open and configure using the config object, reading the method and URL from the object sent in, and we are sending. And when we get an answer back, we are executing this code. And this code, first of all, looks at the status flag for the response. If it's above 400, it's an error. So if it's above 400, we just calls this callback and adds the status code, the error code, as an error. Maybe we should created a new error or something like that. But I think I do that in my example. But in this case, we just send the error code back. If it succeeds, if everything is okay, we call the callback function with the first parameter null and the second parameter with the response text. So when we use this one, we add the config and we add the callback function. This is the callback function. The first argument is the error, and the second argument sent in is the response. This doesn't look that nice. There are some things that bother me about this pattern. It's first of all, sending in null all the time when you don't have an error feels kind of stupid. But we don't have overloading, so we can't like combine those in a good way. This feels quite okay. We add the callback and just send the error. That seems quite fine. We could maybe throw them around. So if we are having an error, we will send null and the error code. And if we don't have an error, we only send the response text back. However, I'm showing this like this because this is a really common pattern. You will run into this if you look at code in libraries and stuff, and they will have an API like this. But kind of an agreement between in the documentation that, okay, this is how my code works, take it or leave it. I mean, I'm using it like this. You're supposed to provide a callback where the first thing you will get from the callback is the error and the second one is the response or the data or the value, depending on what kind of API you're using. In this case, we're using the using some kind of network API, so it's natural that we have a response, but you will see like data and or value or something else depending on the library you are using. So this is like the old way of doing it, works fine, but since ECMAScript 6 we got a new player in town called Promises, and Promises takes care of this mess because this will get quite messy. So we have something called the callback hell or the Temple of Doom, and it's called the Temple of Doom or Christmas Tree of Doom or whatever, because when you write a lot of asynchronous code, it will start to look something like this. Like, okay, we do a request with a function, and when we get that request, we do another request that depends on the first one, and we add a new callback. And when we get a response from that one, we will do something with that, and we will do a new request, and so on and so on and so forth. So this is called the Temple of Doom. We will get code looking like this within the indention, because you are adding inside of functions all the time. I have excluded error handling in this case, because if I added the error handling between all of those as well, this will just swell and be bigger and bigger and bigger. I haven't looked at this one. Not sure why I added that. But we need a way to solve this, to write the code more intuitive. And this is where Promises come in. And Promises is new to the ECMAScript 2015. Was added last year. The support is pretty good in the browsers. I think we have full support. Can I use Promises? Yeah. So this is pretty good. We will have to live with that. Internet Explorer will never ever implement this, but other browsers do. So the support is good. You could use it out of the box. So a promise is, I mean, you can hear it on the name. It's a promise of something. I promise, instead of giving you, I mean, the classical example is promises from the bank. You go to the bank, I want to buy a house, and the bank won't do like, okay, great, here's a million Swedish kronor, take those and go buy yourself a house. No, of course they won't. They will give you a promise saying, okay, we as a bank promise that we will lend you the money if you find a house. And then you could take this paper, you can go buy yourself a house using this paper, and then after everything is settled, the bank will loan you the money eventually. You won't get the money up front. Promises is the same way in JavaScript. So instead of giving you, it will say that I promise that somewhere in the future you could use me and run me, more or less. So let's take, I wrote this on the train without an internet connection. I haven't tried it out because Vagrant app didn't work and I was like, oh, miserable. So I think it's right. John, if you find something wrong or someone else finds something wrong, please tell me. I wrote it out of my memory. However, so I rewrote the request function using promises. So what happens now is that we will still take in the config, but we will not take a callback to this request function. Instead, the request function will return a new promise. So when we call the request function down here, request, we will get a promise back saying that, okay, I will process your request, and somewhere in the future, I will have an answer for you. more or less what we are doing with callbacks, but this is more standardized or neat. So, okay, so the promise, in the promise as to the constructor function, you will send in a callback function. So here is the callback function, more or less. And this function has two parameters, reject and resolve. So when this function, when the promise resolves, we will call this resolve function inside of the function. This is quite hard to explain. Let's look at the code. Forget this row right now. Just focus on this one. This is the new XML HTTP request object. And we're adding an event listener like before. Somewhere down the line, something will go south, something will go wrong, and we can call the reject method that is that will be a function when this code runs. Okay, so we could easily, if we get an error, we call reject, and if we get something right, that we are doing something right, we call the resolve instead. This looks quite strange to write like this, and it's a little bit tricky to set it up, but when we have a look below how to use this, it will be pretty much easier. So now we are calling, doing the request, we are getting a promise back. So this will return the promise, and on the promise there are two methods, one called then and one called catch. The then method will be run when the resolve method is called. And the catch method will be run when the reject method is called. So then we could write code like this. So do the request, and then when it's finished, this code will be run. And this is just, I wrote it as an arrow function to fit it all in, but yeah, this could be an anonymous function as well. So the then will take the data that was sent in to the resolve, and it will do something with it. Now it says response. As I said, I was on the train. It should say data there. And the same thing with the catch. It will take a function. So when the reject is called, catch will be run, and we will be able to act upon the error. This is really, really useful in some cases, and the cases are that often you have code that it relies on, okay, say you want to make contact three different servers, and when all of those servers has responded, you want to do something. You can set it up using promises. There are more methods than then and catch. For instance, you can set up that, okay, when these three servers has responded, or these three promises has resolved, it will some code will run. You don't need to take account that you need to have some flags remembering which service has responded or something like that. You could use promises for those kinds of things. You can even have servers race against each other. So if you want to contact a translation API and you have several to use, and some of them are not that reliable, so sometimes they take a long time. You can send out several requests at the same time, and when you get one response back, you can act upon that response and continue your code, and that's called race. In my example that I recorded, I will go over this and set it up probably in a more pedagogical way than I did now. Yeah.
So the resolve and reject, they are also functions, and we are passing in this case a base and catch.
Yeah. So just wondering if I wrote something wrong. But no, I didn't. Because the promise will call the resolve and the reject function when those will be functions that we can when this function is called by promise, resolve and reject will be functions, and we can call those functions with reject or resolve. Yeah.
And they are like a then and catch, or
yeah. So they are probably not those functions, but when this function is called, then will be called down here. They are probably not the same function, but they interact. The promise will wrap this in. So promises is not part of the course. So if you get this one, no, this one, it's fine, because this is so commonly used. But all new APIs written today in browsers and by many developers are utilizing promises instead of this callback pattern. But the callback pattern has been ruling for many years. But today, when you look at new new code, promises is really, really popular. We will have a look at an API called service workers later on in the course, and service workers rely on promises. However, service workers is just a bonus in this course. It's not mandatory to implement something with service workers because it's really new, and the implementation is in web browsers is not that great yet, but it will be probably. But that uses promises. You could take this one step further. There is something called generator functions. I will not go into them. They are not part of the course. But they are like the next step in writing asynchronous JavaScript, having generator functions that could actually, you write the code in a synchronous way. It looks synchronous, but actually, using the keyword yield, you could have the code being asynchronous, but it looks synchronous, more or less. I haven't used generators more than in a simple example, and so I can't say much about them. I haven't wrapped my round around them quite yet, but they are there in the language. I think the support is like Chrome and Firefox. I'm pretty sure Safari haven't implemented generator functions yet. But if you like, you could have a look. I think I might have a reference to a talk about generators. I'm not sure about that. That might be there. Okay, so now we know how to make AJAX calls. And as I said, please look at my example, because I will go through every step in writing an application using this, both with a callback pattern and promises. And you would get a good picture if you look at that. Okay, it's 2 hours, I know. You could speed me up on YouTube if you like. So, JSON. As you've seen, when I sent in a config object in this, like this, I send it in as an object, just simplest object literal you could think of. Just like a method, a key, and a value. And this is objects in JavaScript. How many of you have used XML? Only a couple? Okay, so the other ones, if you're not using XML, if you're communicating between different systems, in which format do you send data? If it's not XML or JSON. How many have used JSON before? Okay, a couple of you, okay. So, XML was this format that was supposed to be the configuration format for all things, and has been. The military had written all the documentation using XML, and XML is really, really used. I mean, if you rename a document, a docx document, Windows Word, Microsoft Word document, rename it to zip, open it, you will have a lot of XML files in there. So XML is quite a standard way of storing data, which is not in a database. However, XML, if you have worked with XML, you know that it could be quite cumbersome to work with. You have like namespaces, you have a lot of overhead, basically. So the data will be there. There will be data in the document, but there will be a lot of other stuff like tags and attributes and a lot of letters that are not data. And parses using XML is often quite hard to work with. And yeah, it's a good format. It could do like everything, but it's hard to work with. It's quite big and it's not slow, but it feels slow. So on the web, the demand for something easier, something less cumbersome, came up. And our friend Douglas Crockford, who is like known in the JavaScript community, he came up with an idea, or he discovered, as he self said, JSON. And what XML solved was that, okay, we look at all programming languages in the world and we try to find a format that will be like where you could express yourself like all those languages with all kind of data. You have no limits. But what Crockford said is, okay, let's look at all those languages and see what they have in common. Okay, they all have strings of some kind and all have numbers. In some languages they are called floats and integers, but they are basically numbers. All have some kind of structure like an array or list or something like that. All have Booleans, more or less, so something that is truthy or falsy. So why not build just a simple format that has those four properties? Objects as well. All languages have some kind of notation for objects, if it's classes and instances of classes, or it's objects, freestanding like in JavaScript, but objects. So he said that, okay, we already have this. So objects in JavaScript, they have numbers, they have strings, they have arrays, and they have Booleans. So why not just use the same notation as when we write object literals in JavaScript and call it JSON and make it a text format that we can send and communicate with other systems? So he did, and it became really, really popular. It is a subset of JavaScript. For instance, you cannot add functions to a JSON object. You can add a function to an object in JavaScript, of course, then it's called a method. But in a JSON object, you can't add functions. It's language independent. It has an RFC if you like to read it, 4627. When we are sending JSON objects backwards and forth on the web, we're using the MIME type application /JSON or the content type application /JSON. You will need to do that in the assignment. You can read more about it at json.org. And we'll have a look at how it looks. So on top, you see a simple JSON object. You will notice some things that are different from when you write objects in JavaScript. We are always using quotation marks when creating the key. So the quotation marks is mandatory in JSON. And this is to get rid of problems like some words are reserved in some languages, like float, for instance, in JavaScript and many other languages. So we write the objects using this style. And this is just text. So this is just a text format. Simple text format that you can send backwards and forwards. We have the data type, string, number, boolean, null, I forgot, object or array. And when you start writing JSON, you could, of course, you could construct those strings by hand. think I discussed it with some of you during the break, that you could like build them as strings, that you start out with this bracket, then you add backslash the quotation mark, name, backslash quotation mark, colon, and so on and so forth. Just like concatenating this all together. But of course, it's much easier to use built-in functions for this, and I will show that. I will also recommend you checking out jsonlint.com or something equal to this site. So if you want to try out JSON, you can write JSON code right in this editor. Name. So yeah, let's try this. I will write it like this. Blah, 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 blah. No, I thought I should do something else. City. Yeah, we all know that. Kalmar. Okay. And we do a validate JSON. Oh, I get an error saying expecting string got undefined on row one. And this is, oh, what is it? It's quite hard to read, but there's something wrong. And the wrongdoing in this one is that those need to be strings as well. The keys. Okay, validating it. Yay, valid JSON. So if you are like sending JSON to our API during the assignment and you get a bad request, first of all, try just to validate the JSON to see that it's valid JSON, so you don't have like a problem if you built the JSON code yourself. But you will probably not do it like this most of the times. Most of the times you will use something like JSON parse or JSON stringify. So built in to the browser, you have the JSON object, the JSON with capital letters, and you have a parse method. If you send in an array or an object to the parse method, no, wrong. If you send in a string like the one we constructed, just a string with JSON-like code or JSON code, JSON parse will parse this string and make it native objects in JavaScript. And then after the parse, you could go on working with the object as you're used to. Stringify is the opposite. So if you add or call stringify with an object or an array, you will get a string back with a representation of the JSON or the JSON code. We could have a look at the example. I hope you can see that. I can't make it bigger. Okay. So in the code, I create an object. This is a JavaScript object. So I just create a simple object. I'm using var because it's an old slide. So let object, we could use instead, let object equals an object with name Ellen, age 25, and city Kalmar. If I log the object, we get the first row. So we can see in the console log that this is an object because it's represented in the console like a JavaScript object. Then I send it to stringify, and back I will get a string representation of the object. So if we look at the string representation of the object, it will look like the middle row. So that's just a string. And it's this string you can send to another server because that's platform independent. And then if I get a string from a server containing JSON, I can do the JSON.parse and I get an object back. And this is a simple object, but to parse, you can send in an array, for instance. So an array containing objects is also valid JSON. Please share the new slides. Oh yeah, I couldn't even do a git push on the train, I think. Nope. Operation timed out, fatal. Git push. Now it's done. Okay. JSON is really simple. When you are going to write an application against an API on the web, and the API says, I will respond in JSON, you will be happy. If the application says, oh, I will respond in XML, you will be neutral. And if the application say, I will respond in an Excel format, you will be unhappy. So at least it's like this for me. JSON is the simplest thing to work with. If you're using PHP, you could just send JSON to PHP, parse it, and you have PHP objects. If you send it to Java, parse it in Java, and you will have Java objects. So it's really, really simple and easy to work with. Okay, that's about JSON. I'm overdue. Okay, you will be using forms in this assignment. You will be using forms for user input, and I've written here. Make sure the normal forms work with that JavaScript. We need to just separate web applications from websites. If you're doing a website with a contact form, that form should work even if the user have no JavaScript activated. And you do that by making sure that the submit button will send this form to the server the old-fashioned way with a reload and all what that means. Can't do that yet because we haven't written code on the server, but you should always strive for that. If you're writing a web application, a rich web application, then you cannot probably make it work without JavaScript, and then you don't need to think about this. The second assignment, you don't need to make it work without JavaScript. It's totally fine if it doesn't. And I think it's hard to make it work without JavaScript. I will not get into this. This is disable the submit button. Have you ever been been on a web page where you like submit, nothing happens, and you submit again? Yeah, that's how I bought two iPhones from Telia a couple of weeks ago. True story. So if the submit button doesn't work and the user keep clicking, there is a risk that it will send multiple requests to the server and all those requests will be served. So if you're writing code, please, when the user clicks the button and you are in control of the click, just disable the button. So if you get some problems, network connectivity or something like that, the button is disabled and the user can't click it and you will not get any more events. That's a simple, simple thing, but it will do a lot to the user experience. So I have a demo, please look it up. I will go through forms there. I should speak about storing data on the client side today. It will be really, really quick because it's not hard. We have three different ways of storing data. We have the cookies, we have the web storage, and we have the IndexedDB. Cookies has been around since forever. It's just text file being placed in the user's computer, being sent with every request to the server so the server can identify the browser. This is needed for login, for instance, for the server to being able to know what kind of client this is. There are new techniques of doing this, but cookies is the most classical way. Web storage is a newer way of storing data structured in the browser. And IndexedDB is a more full-worthy database if you are processing a lot of data on the client. Often you are not, but in some separate cases, you might be interested in looking into this. We will focus on the middle one, the web storage, because that's the most interesting of the APIs. So cookies look something like this. If you look them up in the browser, they have limitations on the size, and you can only assign 50 cookies per domain. This could differ from browser to browser, but this is according to the RFC. Web storage API, simple key value storage in the browser. You have the set item and the get item. So you set item, first argument is the key, second argument is the value. Simple as that. You set and you read them back. And you can see how it looks in the browser. You could always on the resources go in, have a look at local storage and you will find those. Web storage has two different storages, local storage, session storage. Local storage is permanent in the browser. So if the user shuts down the browser and the computer restarts, goes back, local storage is there. Session storage is only saved during the session. So if the user closes his or her web browser, that data will be erased. So session storage is good if you want to save temporarily data. Local storage if you want to save it more permanently. remember though, the web browser is a hostile environment. I said it last lecture. So of course the user could change browser, the user could reinstall something. Maybe the browser thinks that you have stored too much in the local storage and deletes it. So you can never be sure, but that's how it's supposed to be anyway. You could remove an item as well. I have, there is a good demo of web storage. It's a really simple API. It's asynchronous as well. It's not asynchronous because those calls are really, really fast. However, you often don't want to do it like this, just creating new keys all the time. It's a much simpler and cleaner way of using web storage is adding JSON objects to the storage. So instead, we create an object called style. We set our own keys like this, and then we just save the JSON stringified inside of the web storage. And then we could read it back and parsing it, and we get the object back. So this is probably how you will use web storage. But it's quite simple and quite straightforward. The last thing I want to talk about, and I won't dwell on upon this, but it's the lagen om elektronisk kommunikation. The law of electronic communication law that we have in Sweden. All of you that have visited pages, sites in Sweden, know that if you visit the site, you will get this big thing saying, this site is using cookies, do you accept cookies? And this stems from this law that we have had for quite a few years. If you look up this on the PTS, this is the Post and Telestyrelsen, and that's the authority that is looking after this law. They will call it the cookie law, more or less. And by developers, this is called the cookie law. And that's because PTS only writes about cookies on their page. But if you read in the law, which I did, it doesn't say cookies. It's the PTS that says cookies. In the law, it says that if an application is storing data in the user's terminal, this terminal is not the command prompt. It's like an old word for computer, more or less. But if the browser tries to store data on the terminal or the computer, we should get messages that we comply with doing so. So I would argue that you need to have something like this on Swedish web pages if you're using cookies, web storage, indexed DB. So as soon as you are storing data on the client, you need this according to the law. PTS did a big raid last year on this, and that's why the number of those popping up has increased over the last year. This is quite ironical though. The first time I visited police.se, it says on the police webpage, cookies are being used. I accept cookies. And before I press the button, they have set like 10 cookies or something like that, which is actually not okay, but it's probably their CMS doing this. So it's quite hard often to get around it. Cache is like the web cache is not a part of this because that's built in to make everything work. There is some kind of saying that if it's necessary to make something work, then it's okay. So it's a really complicated law and everybody hates it more or less, but it's there. And I need to inform you that if you write those kind of applications, you should have something like this in Sweden. So I said it. Yeah. Nothing more. Lunch. Okay, so after lunch, peer instruction, make sure to be here because it will be fun. Okay? Thanks.